A state commission wants to make financial interests in the Roundhouse more transparent. The State Ethics Commission is calling for stricter rules when it comes to financial disclosures for state lawmakers. The commission calls the current law, quote, vague and undemanding, end quote. Interesting word there, undemanding. It wants to require more detailed reports on income and financial interests, saying that would deter corruption and increase transparency. Now, given last year's resignation from House Speaker Cheryl Williams Stapleton amidst allegations she misused her position with APS, are these necessary, Rebeca Latham, are these necessary changes as you see them?
And when you read that Disclosure Act as it's proposed, it feels way overboard. Mm-hmm. I mean, getting down to like reporting gifts that your children receive, and I'm fully in favor of more transparency.
Right.
We all want a more transparent government, but this just feels really burdensome. Mm-hmm. And I think it's interesting that like the state wants to know everything about your money, but they're not prepared to give you an honest income, right? These elected officials are not receiving any money.
I love that.
So, I think it could be, I worry, mm-hmm. while we love transparency, I worry that this could be a deterrent for some really great potential public servants. And do we really want to make it harder to find quality candidates? I don't think so.
Let me let the folks know what Rebecca's getting at here, because I think she's onto something interesting. The new Disclosure Act proposed by the commission would outline detailed requirements for the disclosure of personal assets, debts, sources of family income over $600, including earnings by spouses, independent children, and property ownership. And Serge, I gotta ask you a question. If your oldest kid had a good month with their Poshmark and they made 900 bucks, why is that Santa Fe's business?
Well, that seems like a far-fetched hypothetical, but I'll allow it.
Time out. A Poshmark or a Mercury account making 800 bucks is far from far-fetched.
Oh, sorry. I meant it doesn't apply to my children.
But, oh, gotcha.
they wear hoodies at all times.
Gotcha.
I think, it is. It's intrusive. It's probably overkill. It's probably what we're seeing is the sort of classic, well, let's, make sure we're responding to the last thing that happened, mm-hmm. right? As someone described it as scandal first, law second, right? And then we try to fix that last thing that just happened, and sort of an overcorrection, right, to all the stuff that we've seen recently. But, mm-hmm. I will go off on a slight tangent here. You've heard me complain before about our legislative setup here. Mm-hmm. When you have an unpaid legislature, right, who have to have jobs to support themselves, you're asking for setups that are going to lead to conflicts. And that is part of, what is going to be driving things like these possibly overreaching ethics rules, right? When they're sitting up in Santa Fe in the Roundhouse that's awash with lobbying money, and we know that they're not getting paid, the perception is almost certainly going to be, well, who wouldn't be tempted to, to have conflicts, right, and whatnot. So I think, this underscores this problem that I have hammered home repeatedly, that we have got to get a better legislative setup.
Right.
And that wouldn't, it's not that other legislatures do not have ethical scandals. Obviously, those come with the territory. But we have a particular type of issue here that we are setting ourselves up for, and trying to micromanage the finances of someone's family is a response to that. But the real response, I think, the better response is to step back and say, okay, wait a second. How do we set up a system that is not going to lead to the sort of these built-in conflicts?
Mm-hmm. Good point there. Inez, as we're going to get around here, as Serge just mentioned about full or part-time legislatures, all that kind of thing. But I got to go back to my example that Rebeca brought up about intrusiveness in this $600 threshold. Where do things like that come from? Are they rooted in some kind of reality? Is this the problem when you have committees looking at how people work? Because I got to tell you something. Money comes into families through many odd routes. And to build a narrative about how your family income works through your kids' stuff, your wife's stuff, whatever, I just can't see people really getting warm to that. I really can't. There's something almost intrusive about it. Laying out your family financial map and how money comes in from all these weird directions. What is this going to work in Santa Fe for people that live in Santa Fe that have to work up there?
you know, it's intrusive, but you know, you're choosing to run. You're choosing to be an elected official, and you're choosing to be married to a lobbyist, for example, who then is mm-hmm. going to lobby you on bills that you vote on. And most of the legislators do not recuse themselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a reason that sometimes you go too far in writing a proposal, because maybe they know the kids and the $600 are going to get thrown off, but we might get to keep finding out what the spouses are doing. Because there really is, I think, a question about spousal income that does affect how legislators operate and how they vote. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the scandals
is
that we've had,
let me ask you this: is that not a reasonable place to start, and instead of throwing this blanket net of $600 and asking if your, you know, good for nothing brother-in-law finally paid you that $1,500 for that trailer, that you got to suddenly report this? I mean, what does that actually show? When it comes,
I think they must have more thinking. I'm going to have to go ask them what they were thinking. But think about the different legislators who've had kids, who have worked at the legislature, who have then influenced their dads or their moms. There's probably something here that we don't know, mm-hmm. and it may be overreaching, but we've underreached for so many years. Maybe we should overreach for a little bit. I agree with Serge, and we've written about it in our paper. You mm-hmm. know, we need to go beyond a citizen legislature. We need to pay people for doing work. Mm-hmm. We need to remove the potential for temptation and conflict. And we need to watch people more. I mean, who was watching Cheryl Staples Williamson those years, mm-hmm. whether at the school district or at, you know, the ethics at the legislature? Mm-hmm. We need to do better. And maybe for a while, legislators are going to stand naked before us and all their finances to get where we need to get.
Mm-hmm. Serge, additionally, disclosure requirements cover membership in corporations and nonprofit groups, gifts of $50 or more from lobbyists, and work done by an official or their spouse involving public agencies. You know, that's okay. I could see that. But gifts of 50, I mean, it sounds like something, an answer from out of the 80s. I mean, And I know this has a way to go. This is the reason we have committees. You know what I mean? So I'm not mm-hmm. saying this is the final thing. But again, right. is this going to do anything, disclosing membership in corporations and nonprofit groups? I just don't see the trail here.
I mean, I think, you know, some of this is obviously symbolic and maybe will shape certain folks' behavior, or, you know, mm-hmm. think about what they might be doing to inform. This is the standard that we're trying to hold you to, rather than, you know, we're going to go in and investigate every single little aspect of your life. I've seen some suggestions that the more of these rules that you get, the less trust people have in government, because they're like, well, there must be a lot of shadiness going on if they have to legislate it down to this particular level. I suppose that's a possible risk. I mean, I am in favor of well-crafted and thoughtful rules. Mm-hmm. I think, as you're pointing out, right, well-crafted and thoughtful sounds great until you have to put a number on a piece of paper.
Right.
And the source of that, $50 seems low to me, but I actually don't get that many gifts at all, so I don't know how to value them.
I hear that. Hey, Rebeca, real quick, the Ethics Commission is also calling for an amendment to the Lobbyist Regulation Act. Now, this is interesting. It wants to bar former statewide elected officials from being paid as lobbyists for 2 full years after leaving office. This is not a new idea, even at the federal level. Will that help limit special interest control in the Roundhouse, doing it that way?
I think it's such a systemic problem that nothing will limit special interest control. I don't know that's, I don't know. I think it's a great idea, a great thought. I certainly have seen my share of colleagues who transitioned immediately into lobbying.
Right.
And I feel like, you know, there's a point where you wonder, you know, are we going to go into contact tracing, where anytime a lawmaker and a lobbyist have, you know, passed or crossed paths in the grocery store aisle, or then someone is alerted that they've been in the same place at the same time? You know, it's a terrible system. It is a terrible system. It's horribly flawed. It has to be fixed. But I don't know that telling someone, if you're going to retire from being an elected official, that now you can't, a job that we haven't paid you for,
right,
but now you can't go into another job that where you could take what you've learned. Like, we wouldn't do that in any other career path, and saying like, you can't take what you've learned in this career and then parlay it into something better for yourself. Mm-hmm. So it just feels like that's overly burdensome.
Good point there. Hey guys, in 2020, a report by New Mexico Ethics Watch, just to make Rebecca's point here, found that 34 ex-legislators worked as lobbyists and that another 6 lobbyists were spouses or relatives of legislators. And Inez, I think that sort of makes your point you were starting to make, or you did make about 3 or 4 minutes ago, isn't it? That it's mm-hmm. there's a lot, when you look in the nooks and crannies of who's doing what, it might look a little bit worse than we actually realize.
We're just a small state, and yeah. If you're married to somebody, it's likely that they're going to affect what you do, and that works whether you're an editorial page editor or a legislator. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've gotten ugly postcards saying you can't write about Native Americans because you're married to one. And, you know, I am. So it's all true. But mm-hmm. we all have conflicts. But the difference is I'm not writing laws that will necessarily enrich myself
right.
or my spouse or my child. And legislators potentially can be. Mm-hmm. And I think taxpayers deserve to know their connections without being overly intrusive or burdensome on these wonderful citizens who are giving up their time and their livelihoods to work for us.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff. Good stuff there. Good discussion, guys, all the way around. I really like this. As always, this week, be sure to let us know what you think about any of the topics the line covered on our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram pages.